هيا على الفلاح
Stay away from most assumptions, because some assumptions are sinful. Allah teaches us something here. What's so terrible about assumptions? Because you're assuming something on someone's behalf, but what makes it worse? Because it leads to other bad things, because it's in the heart. So Allah says, don't spy on people. When you start assuming things about people, you become suspicious of people, then you want to confirm your suspicion. So you go snooping around, poking into people's business, creeping and stalking, trying to confirm your suspicions about people. Then Allah says, once you start spying and creeping and stalking people, guess what? You might be able to confirm some of your suspicions. And you find out, oh my God, he is doing this. Oh my God, she is doing that. You know what happens when you have a juicy piece of information like that? You develop the worst stomach ache that you've ever had in your entire life, because you have to now tell somebody about this. You go to somebody and you tell them, hey, listen, I'm gonna tell you something, but please don't tell anybody. Promise to me you won't tell anybody. Which is basically code for, right after I'm done telling you, make sure you go tell somebody just like I told you. It's called backbiting. What is the definition of ghiba, backbiting? So the Prophet ﷺ told us, it is you saying something about somebody else that they would not appreciate you saying. The companion asked the Prophet ﷺ, well, what if what I'm saying is true? Then that is the very definition of backbiting. If what you're saying about that person isn't true, that's slander. That's an even bigger crime and even a bigger issue. But saying something that somebody else would not appreciate you saying about them is the definition of backbiting.
Now, scholars of Islam have agreed that it is haram to backbite a person for no legitimate purpose. Most of them stated that it's actually a major sin and that it varies in degree. Some people actually backbite the Sahaba. They criticize Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Umar radiallahu anhu, Uthman radiallahu anhu. Even though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, radiallahu anhum wa radu anhu. Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Allah. So these people, they've done something very disgusting and they've actually backbit the Sahaba. Imagine these people, they backbite the wife of the Prophet ﷺ, Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. So this is a great sin, and therefore backbiting actually varies from person to person. And so the sin of backbiting is something great in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, Aisha radiallahu anha, she said something that annoyed the Prophet ﷺ. And she actually backbit another of the wives of the Prophet ﷺ. What did he say? He said, you said a word that if it was mixed with the water of the sea, it would contaminate the sea. The Prophet ﷺ, he asked the Sahaba, he said, do you know what is backbiting? And the companions replied, Allah and His Messenger ﷺ know best. And upon that, the Prophet ﷺ said, backbiting is to talk about your brother in a manner which he does not like. They asked the Prophet ﷺ, suppose that there are actual faults in the one that I'm talking about. If what you say about your brother is true, then that is backbiting. But if what you say concerning him is not true, you have in fact committed buhtan, which is slander against him. So what's the difference between backbiting and slander? If you backbite the person, it's true. If you slander him, it's something that's not true. But the common link between them is the person does not like what you're saying about him. Al-Imam An-Nawawi rahimahullah, one of the great scholars of the past, he said in his book Al-Athkar, and I quote, he says, mentioning about your brother something that he would dislike includes what concerns his body, his religious practice, his worldly station, his physical appearance, his moral character, his wealth, his parents, his children, his spouse, his servant, his clothing, his activities, his smiles and frowns, and anything else that pertains to him. So you can imagine how dangerous it is and how easy it is for us to fall into this evil sin. It doesn't matter if you mention it, Imam An-Nawawi goes on to say, explicitly by word or implicitly by indication or by gesture. This includes the likes of saying, so and so is coming, oh Allah help us. Or saying, oh Allah keep us safe. Even making dua to Allah in this manner, a person has fallen into backbiting. This is what many people think, that backbiting actually means you can't speak about someone that he doesn't like behind his back, but if I say in front of him, that's okay. This is incorrect. Because the Prophet ﷺ did not actually mention this in the hadith. He said, what is ghiba? Ghiba is to mention your brother in a way that he dislikes. Whether that's in front or behind. In fact, this is why some of the scholars, they gave the tafsir of the verse, woe be to every humaza and lumaza. They said one of them is the one who backbites in front of the person, and one of them is the one who backbites behind his back. And some scholars said actually it's one is a slanderer and one is a backbiter. But one can advise on these kind of things. Now, backbiting is a very evil sin in Islam. And we can take one example from the Sahaba. When one Sahabi criticized a man who had been punished for committing adultery, and someone backbit this person. Now the Prophet ﷺ was traveling and he passed by the carcass of a donkey. And he said, where are those two people who spoke badly about the one who committed adultery? Get down and eat from the flesh of this donkey. And they were surprised. They said, Ya Rasulullah, who would eat this? It's a dead carcass, carcass of a donkey. He said, what the two of you have recently done by defaming the honor of your brother is far worse than eating from this. Allahu Akbar. Now if this is the case, what about backbiting people who have not committed a major sin? What about backbiting scholars or people who call to or fight for Islam? And this is a very common slip up. The callers to Islam are this, the Maulvis are this. And this is all comes under backbiting if he speaks about a particular individual. Now Muslims should not backbite others, but should be concerned with their own faults. And if we find a fault with our brother, we should advise him and guide him to eliminate his faults rather than vilifying him. The Sahaba actually, they and the early Muslim scholars, they actually knew the reality of backbiting and its punishment. And they saw the weightiness of this. They were very careful about what they would utter. And in fact, even after that, they would be fearful of their tongues. We know the famous example of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. He pointed to his tongue and he said, this is the thing that caused me most destruction. And this is very worrying for us. If Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the one who is known for his honesty, he is soft, he is calm, and he says something like this, that this is the thing that destroyed me, his tongue, then how about us? How much more fearful should we be? In fact, it's narrated that Al-Hasan al-Basri, rahimahullah, the great tabi'i, he died in the year 110 after Hijrah. Al-Hasan al-Basri, he was once backbitten. Somebody came to him and said, hey, you know, so-and-so is backbiting me. So what did he do? He got some dates and he sent them as a gift to the one who backbit him. And then he said, he wrote a letter. He said, it has reached me that you have gifted me some of your good deeds. So I wanted to repay you for that, but I apologize, I'm unable to repay you in full. And this shows that he understood the reality of backbiting, which is what? Who is backbiting really harming? Because there's no dirham nor dinar on that day. A'udhu billah, if I backbit someone, may Allah protect us from that, then one has to give his good deeds to that person. If he runs out of good deeds, then he takes his sins. This is how it will be judged, Yawm al-Qiyamah. And so we have to be very careful. And Al-Hasan al-Basri, he recognized this very carefully. And that's why he said that if I were to backbite anyone, it would be my parents. Because it's his parents, he wants to gift them his good deeds. Because he knows the reality of backbiting. In fact, backbiting is like a gift. If the person forgives him, then inshaAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive him. Now if backbiting is such an evil sin, and the punishment is so great, then why do people do it? Other people are backbiting, hey, let's join in, it can't be that bad.
Yes.
Peer pressure to character assassinate or something like this. Yeah. Jealousy, for example, a person is jealous. He feels jealous, he wants other people, and maybe someone else is praising that person. When he has weak iman, weak taqwa, then a person, he's likely to speak thoughtlessly, without thinking, and maybe he can transgress against his own self. Likewise, as you said, it reduces his anger. He wants to reduce his anger, vent out his anger by mentioning his faults. Having bad thoughts about someone is another reason why a person could backbite. He has bad thoughts about the one he's backbiting. Sometimes actually, a person wants to absolve himself of bad characteristics. So for example, maybe he's a thief. And he mentions, oh, so-and-so is a thief. Why? To absolve himself of this bad character from himself. Maybe he wants to raise himself up. He wants people to look up to him. So any kind of contemporary, if he likes, he pushes him down. He mentions his faults, mocking, joking, belittling others, and so on and so forth. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.